गुड मॉर्निंग, माय नेम इज बी हरीश। आई एम वर्किंग एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स एंड कम्युनिकेशन इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट इन विज्ञान लारा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी एंड साइंस वडलमोड़ी। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट वेरी important as well as interesting subject in fourth year first semester. The subject is optical communications. This course is studied in BTech fourth year first semester in all engineering colleges affiliated to JNTU Kakinada. The university is prescribing two textbooks for studying this course. The first one is Optical Fiber Communication. Gerd Kaiser is the author. The publisher is McGraw-Hill International. The second textbook is Optical Fiber Communication. The author is John M. Senior. The publisher is Prentice Hall. When we compare two textbooks, according to JNTU Kakinada syllabus, the entire syllabus is covered in Optical Fiber Communication by Gerd Kaiser textbook. So this textbook covers entire syllabus, all the contents of optical communications. Today we will study about the first unit of optical fiber or optical communications. The contents in the unit 1 are overview and history of optical fiber communication, general system and advantages of optical fiber communications, optical fiber waveguides, ray theory transmission, cylindrical fibers. In cylindrical fibers, some miscellaneous topics are there: modes, V number, mode coupling, step index fiber, graded index fibers, single mode fibers, cutoff wavelength, mode field diameter, effective refractive index, etc. In this session, we will discuss about the first unit of optical communications. The first topic is overview and history. In the year 1880, Alexander Graham Bell introduced a device which is called as photophone at Bell Volta Labs. This photophone is also called as radiophone. It is a device with which we can transmit the speech signals in the form of light. This is the first device introduced by Graham Bell in the year 1880 to transmit the speech signals in the form of light. You can see the picture here. The Graham Bell is the scientist Graham Bell. He is sending the speech signals. He is talking something. You can see the device here, the setup. This setup is called as photophone or radiophone. The speech signals are being converted into light signals and transmitted to certain distance. This device is called as photophone device. Later, in the year 1970, it was little bit, the optical fiber was developed by Corning Glass Works with less attenuation for communication purposes. In the year 1975, The first optical system, optical communication system, was developed using lasers, where gallium arsenic semiconductor material is used. There are many applications of optical communications. Among them, you can see the biomedical, important biomedical application, which is an endoscopic imaging. Endoscopic imaging or colonoscopic imaging are used in the medical field to find out the traces of ulcers in the gastrointestinal path using a device called as endoscopic or colonoscopic imaging. This device consists of a long tube. One end of the long tube is having a camera. The other end of the long tube is connected to the processor or a computer. This long tube internally consists of optical fiber. The videos or pictures captured by the camera are transmitted at high speed to the computer through optical fiber tube only. The next one is, nowadays we can observe the fiber grids or communication through fiber network, long distance communication through fiber network. And the third one is, a high information security is available in optical communication, which is very much helpful in military applications. Later we will see how information is secured in optical communication in the coming topics. The optical fiber communication system is a communication system which consists of transmitting part as well as receiving part. If you observe this communication system, it looks like general communication system like information source, electrical transmitter at the transmitting end, electrical receiver or the loudspeaker or destination at the receiver. But there are some important blocks which are helpful to convert the speech or information into light and transmit over the optical fiber cable. For example, the optical source blocks, optical fiber cable, optical detectors and the receivers. These are the important blocks which are present in optical fiber communication system, which makes the difference between the generalized communication system and the optical fiber communication system. There are many advantages of optical communication system. The bandwidth is very high. Optical fibers or optical fiber cables are very, very lightweighted. Noise interference is less. There will be no crosstalk. Short circuit risk factors are very, very less. Can be operated at high temperatures. The transmission losses as well as cost are also less. Then, what is the difference between optical communication and general coaxial cable communication system? Here is the list. So, there are some points here which makes the difference between optical fiber and coaxial cable. Optical fiber is used to transmit the signals in the form of light. If it is coaxial cable, signal is transmitted in the electrical form. Optical fibers are made up of plastics and glasses. whereas coaxial cable is made up of plastic or plastics and as well as copper wires. Optical fiber is highly efficient than coaxial cable. The weight of the optical fiber, optical cable is very less. The diameter is also very small. But the installation, maintenance and implementation of optical fiber is difficult. This is the disadvantage of optical fiber. Whereas if it is coaxial cable, installation, implementation as well as maintenance of coaxial cable is very easy. Next one is, there is a high noise immunity in optical fibers, whereas coaxial cable it is less. And similarly, some power losses can happen due to scattering losses, dispersion losses, bending losses, absorption losses in optical fiber. And if it is coaxial cable, it may occur due to the improper conduction. You can observe some disadvantages. A complex circuitry is required at transmitter as well as receiver ends, and maintenance of the optical cable or troubleshooting of the optical communication system is very difficult, because the coupling of the two optical fibers is not that much easy like a coaxial cable optical communication system. Coaxial cable communication system. Separate power supplies are required for every repeater stages in optical communication system. So these are some disadvantages of optical communication system. Although these are disadvantages, there is a huge advantage, like the bandwidth is very high, the less weight, less cost, etc. There are many advantages compared to the disadvantages of optical communication system. This is the digital optical fiber link. You can observe same transmitter end as well as receiver end are available in the digital optical fiber links, which consists of encoder block, optical source, here it is a laser driving circuit, an optical fiber cable, an amplifier and an equalizer block, a decoder block and a digital output. Next topic is optical fiber waveguides. What this optical fiber internally consists of? Internally it consists of three different regions. The first internal region is core. It is encapsulated with another region called as cladding, and the core and cladding are encapsulated using the uppermost layer. It is called as sheath. The refractive index of core and cladding are not same. The refractive index of cladding is always lower than the core, and the sheath always protects the core and cladding regions from the external temperature or external pressures. Due to the difference in the refractive indices between core and cladding, light wave always will travel within the core region only. It will not be getting outside of the core region. The maintaining this kind of difference between refractive indices, different refractive indices of core and cladding, is to to achieve total internal reflection, which is the main principle behind the light propagation in a optical fiber cable. You can see the definition. Fiber optic communication is a method of transmitting the information from one place to another place by sending pulses of light through an optical fiber. The optical fiber is a dielectric waveguide that operates at optical frequencies. Generally, these optical fibers are available in cylindrical form only. The function is, it confines electromagnetic energy in the form of light within its surfaces and guides the light in the direction parallel to the axis of core. Before going to understand the principle of optical communication, some fundamental concepts are required with which we can understand how a light is propagated inside the core from the transmitting end to the receiving end without deviating the axis of the core. These basics include the law of reflection, the law of refraction, total internal reflection, etc. If you see the first one, law of reflection, the law of reflection states that the incident ray and the reflected ray and the normal to the surface all lie in the same plane. Incident ray means the ray of light projected onto the surface. When the ray of light is projected onto the surface, some part of the light will get reflected. It is called as reflected ray. If you observe, there exists a normal with respect to the surface. The angle made by the incident ray with respect to the normal is called as angle of incidence. The angle made by the reflected ray with respect to the normal is called angle of reflection. This angle of incidence, angle of reflection are very much important to understand the light propagation. The next one is refraction. When a ray of light passes from one medium to another, it changes its direction at the interface. For example, when the light wave travels from low dense medium to high dense medium, then wave gets refracted towards the normal or bends towards the normal. Similarly, when the light wave travels from more dense medium to less dense medium, the light will bend away from the normal. The refraction takes place because light travels at different speeds in different mediums. You can observe two figures here. There is a torch light which is acting as a source to project the incident light. If you observe, consider the source is present in the medium called as air, whose refractive index is say N1, and another medium say water, whose refractive index is N2. Here refractive index N1 is less than N2, or refractive index of air is less than refractive index of water. What happens? The light is propagating from low dense medium to high dense medium. So the ray is bending towards the normal. See the second case. The same source of light is projected onto the surface, but not from the air medium, from the water. If you observe here, the water having refractive index high compared to the refractive index air, say N2. Okay, here N1 is greater than N2. That is, light is coming from higher dense medium to lower dense medium. You can see here, when the light travels from more dense medium to less dense medium, then light wave gets bent or refracted away from the normal. The same thing you can observe here. It is the refracted rays going away from the normal, not towards the normal. This is called the principle or law of refraction. Here, refractive index is a parameter which is the amount of refraction or bending of that occurs at the two interfaces of the materials of different densities. It is generally represented as with a letter small n, which is equal to speed of light in vacuum by speed of light in medium. There was a scientist called Snell. He proposed a law with the principles of reflection and refraction, and that law is named as Snell's law. Snell's law is defined as the ratio of sine of the angle of incidence to the sine of the angle of refraction is a constant. The ratio of sine of the angle of incidence to the sine of the angle of refraction is a constant. And you can see the relation here, N1 sin theta 1 is equal to N2 sin theta 2, or sin theta 1 by sin theta 2 equal to N2 by N1, which is a constant. You can observe theta 1, N1 and N2 are refractive indices of two media. Theta 1 and theta 2 are incidence angle and angle of refraction. There is another theory called as ray transmission theory. There is another theory called as ray transmission theory, where optical light in an optical fiber is explained as a ray theory as well as mode theory. So it says that two types of rays can be propagated through the optical fibers. They are called as meridional rays, and the other one is skew rays. Meridional rays are the rays which are transmitted passing through the fiber axis. Generally, they are bounded rays and unbounded rays. These generally bounded rays are trapped in the core and propagated along the fiber axis. Unbounded rays are refracted out of the core of the fiber. If you see the skew rays, they don't follow the fiber axis. Instead, they travel in an helical path. They don't touch the fiber axis at all, core fiber axis at all. They travel from one end to another end in the optical fiber in an elliptical path or helical path. You can observe two figures here. The first figure is the light ray propagating in the core fiber along the fiber axis. The second ray is the light ray propagating in the optical fiber in an helical path. The first figure is representing the ray inside the first optical fiber. The first figure represents meridional ray, and the helical way of propagation in the second figure, you can observe that ray is called as skew ray. The next important topic is total internal reflection. Before knowing that, there is an important parameter called as critical angle. The angle of incidence in a denser medium, for which angle of refraction in the rarer medium is 90 degrees, then it is called critical angle. It is very much important to find out the critical angle in order to propagate the or in order to make the light to incident inside the core, so that light propagates only inside the core without refracting outside the core, that is without moving outside the core. In order to make the light reflected completely internally inside the core, the measurement of critical angle plays a crucial role. There is a figure here. There are three, the figure is divided into three parts. You can observe there are two media, air and water. For example, the light is incident from the water to the surface, so some part of the light is reflected back and some part is getting refracted. Say for example, angle of refraction which is making with the normal is say r, small r. It is visible in the figure 1. You can see the pointer. I made the incident light, or the I increase the incident light so that the angle of refraction or the refracted ray is coming away from the normal. You can see the second one, so that the refracted ray is passing over the surface or the interface. Here the refracted ray is making an angle called 90 degrees, an angle of 90 degrees with the normal. Here the angle of refraction, the angle of refraction, if the angle of refraction is 90 degrees, when the angle of refraction is 90 degrees, the corresponding angle of incidence is called as critical angle. If you observe the third figure, I increase the incident angle of incidence more than critical angle, so that the refracted ray is completely bending, into the same medium. You can see the third figure. It is visible for us like there is an incident angle, there is a reflected angle, there is no refracted angle, there is no refracted ray at all. There is an incident ray, there is an reflected ray, but there is no refracted ray. That means whatever the amount of light which is propagated or incident at the two surfaces, at the surface of the two media, is being completely reflected into the same medium. Totally reflected into the same medium. This principle is called as total internal reflection. So total internal reflection means when the angle of incidence is greater than the critical angle, then the light ray completely reflects, totally reflects into the same media. It is called as total internal reflection. This total internal reflection is very much important for propagation of the light in the optical fiber, and it holds as a very good principle in optical communication. You can observe from the Snell's law, already we know n1 sin theta 1 is equal to n2 sin theta 2. Here theta 1 is treated as angle of incidence, theta 2 is treated as angle of refraction. But when we consider the critical angle, that is angle of incidence is equal to critical angle, say theta c, then angle of refraction, say theta 2, is becoming 90 degrees. I am substituting the same thing in the Snell's law. So it is becoming n1 sin theta c equal to n2 sin 90. Or I can say sin theta c, sin of critical angle, is the ratio of n2 and n1, two refractive indices. This calculation of critical angle is very much important to make the incident light propagate inside the core without any refraction into the cladding. There are two conditions for obtaining total internal reflection in a optical fiber. The first one is, always incident angle should be greater than critical angle. That is the first one. Second one is, light should travel from higher refractive index material to lower refractive index material, or higher density material to lower density material, or higher density medium to lower density medium. These are the two conditions which must be followed in optical communication to transmit the light inside the core without any refraction into the cladding, or to obtain total internal reflection. There are few more important parameters in ray theory. The one is acceptance angle, another one is numerical aperture. The acceptance angle is the maximum angle at which light entering inside the core is transmitted through the fiber and is propagated without being refracted. It is the maximum angle beyond which the total internal reflection cannot happen. So that angle is called as acceptance angle. Mathematically, it is given as theta max, or acceptance angle, equal to sine inverse of root of n1 square minus n2 square. Another one is numerical aperture. It is a dimensionless parameter in an optical system. It characterizes the range of angles over which system can accept or emit light. Numerical aperture is equal to sin theta max. In other words, it can be treated as acceptance angle only. Next topic is cylindrical fibers. A dielectric waveguide that operates at optical frequencies is called as optical fiber. It is already we know. Generally, these optical fibers are available in cylindrical forms. Generally, these are step index fibers. Another one is graded index fibers. In a fiber, if only one mode is transmitted through it, then it is called as, then is said to be single mode fiber. The refractive index is less than 1, the cladding refractive index is less than 4. Here there will be an abrupt change in refractive index at the core cladding interface. Abrupt change in the refractive index at the core cladding interface. Next one is grade index fiber. The refractive index of the core is made to vary gradually or as a function of radial distance taken from the center of the fiber. You can see the figure like this. The refractive index is made to vary gradually, means the core and the cladding, the refractive index of the core will be changing slowly and finally it will reach to the refractive index of the cladding. According to the number of modes of transmission, fibers are single mode and multi mode. Again, single mode are classified into step index, grade index. Multi mode are classified into step index and grade index. If it is single mode, as usual, we can already said, if only one mode is transmitted through the optical fiber, it is called single mode. Some characteristics of the single mode are there. Only one path is available. Whenever the core diameter is very, very small, generally single mode transmission is done. Bandwidth is very high, but the fabrication is difficult and it is costly. Coming to multimode, when more than one mode is to be transmitted, more than one ray is to be transmitted, then we go for multimode fibers. Generally, more than one path is available in multimode fibers and the core diameter is higher. The bandwidth is less, and generally for short distance communication, these multimode fibers are used. The fabrication difficulty is less and cost is less. You can see the different structures of optical fiber based upon the index profiles. You can see that this is the step index fiber. The refractive index of the refractive index of the core is changed abruptly when compared to the refractive index of the cladding. This is actually single. This is actually single mode step index. Only one mode can be traveled. You can see here. This is also step index, but multimode. Multimode means the refractive index is changed abruptly. The refractive index of the core is changed abruptly. Abrupt change you can observe. Since the diameter is more here, the core diameter is more, more number of modes or more number of rays can be transmitted. It is called multimode step index fiber. See the third figure. Here the refractive index of the core is gradually varied to meet the refractive index of the cladding. Here you can observe more number of modes are transmitted. It is called multimode graded index fiber. There is another concept called as mode coupling. Mode coupling means overlapping of the modes or overlapping of the light rays. Due to perturbations occurring in the fiber, light may not make same angles with the axis, due to which overlapping or coupling of the rays or coupling of the modes occur. This is called mode coupling or mode mixing. Generally, deviation of fiber axis from the straightness, variations in the core diameter, variations in the refractive indices along the core cladding interfaces, that is irregularities at the core cladding interface, refractive indices variations, that is what. Generally, these are the reasons for occurrence of mode coupling in an optical fiber cable. Next one is V number. V number, or it is also called as fiber parameter or normalized frequency, which gives the number of modes a fiber can hold or a fiber can support. How many number of, if you see the multimode transmission, how many number of, multimode means many number of modes, many number of rays you can transmit, but many means how many? So there is a limit. It is not infinite, no, there is a limit. So what is the maximum number a optical fiber can hold and transmit? Okay, so that is represented as V number. V number, a small expression is given for the V number. It is pi into d by lambda multiplied by numerical aperture, where d is the diameter of the core, lambda is the wavelength, Na here represents numerical aperture. These are whatever we have studied today. These are all fundamental concepts which are covered in unit 1, with which we can understand how a light is propagated inside an optical fiber, what is meant by refractive index, what is meant by law of reflection, what is Snell's law, what is step index fiber, what is gradient index fiber, what is single mode transmission, what is multi mode transmission. These are all fundamentals of optical communications which are covered in the unit 1 of this subject. In the next session, we'll start the second unit, the fabrication of optical fibers. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.